Hello everyone, my name is Dr. Zarifa Romanova and today we will continue to discuss B vitamins, in particular vitamin B2 or riboflavin. Do you know why milk is currently sold in OPEC cardboard packaging in the United States? Milk and dairy products have very high riboflavin content. Ultraviolet and visible light can rapidly inactivate riboflavin that contains in milk. This is the reason why milk is now typically sold in cartons or OPEC plastic containers to block light. Unfortunately, this is not the case in Russia. Riboflavin or vitamin B2, as you've already guessed, is one of the water-soluble B vitamins. Vitamin B2 doesn't accumulate in the body and must be regularly replenished through complete foods or supplements, like all B vitamins. Riboflavin is an essential component of two major coenzymes, flavin mononucleotide, FMN, and flavin adenine dinucleotide, FAD. These coenzymes play major roles in energy production, cellular function, growth and development, as well as in metabolism of fats, drugs and steroids. Also, these two coenzymes are needed in conversion of vitamin B3 and B6, which make a significant contribution to the normal functioning of the nervous system. A tiny spoiler for my next videos. In general, vitamin B2 participates in redox processes and the synthesis of adenosine triphosphoric acid, ATP, the construction of visual purpura, protects the retina from excessive exposure to ultraviolet rays, and together with vitamin A ensures normal vision, the acuity of perception of color and light, as well as dark adaptation. It has a positive effect on the state of the nervous system, skin and mucous membranes, on liver function, and stimulates hematopoiesis, the formation of blood cellular components. Moreover, vitamin B2 is important for the normal development of the fetus during pregnancy and for the growth of children. Riboflavin might play a role in three health conditions: migraine headaches, cancer, and cardiovascular diseases. Firstly, migraine headaches. This kind of headache typically produces intense pulsing or throbbing pain in one area of the head. A few small randomized trials have shown that taking 400 mg daily of riboflavin for 2 months effectively reduces the frequency of migraine attacks compared to placebo. Another study with riboflavin dosages ranging from 50 to 200 mg per day showed no benefit. The American Academy of Neurology and the American Headache Society concluded that riboflavin is probably effective for preventing migraine headaches and recommended offering it for this purpose. The Canadian Headache Society recommends 400 mg per day riboflavin for migraine headache prevention. Secondly, cancer prevention. Some experts suggest that vitamin B2 may protect cell deoxyribonucleic acid, DNA, from damage by various carcinogens. DNA is the chemical name of the molecule that carries genetic instructions to all living things. Some studies, for example, the Melbourne Collaborative Cohort Study for 15 years, have shown a significant inverse association between dietary riboflavin intake and lung cancer risk in cured smokers. Other studies, like the European Prospective Investigation for 12 years and the Prospective Canadian National Breast Screening Study for 16 years, have found no association between riboflavin intakes and colorectal cancer risk and lung cancer risk, respectively. There is no definite conclusion based on research whether riboflavin might protect against cancer. Further research is needed. And finally, cardiovascular diseases. Riboflavin helps maintain normal levels of homocysteine, an amino acid that enters the diet from animal protein foods like meat. High levels in the blood are a risk factor for cardiovascular disease. Riboflavin works with other B vitamins like B6, folate, and B12 to break down homocysteine in the body. However, epidemiological studies have not shown that applying B vitamin supplementation reduces reduces the risk of heart attacks or death from cardiovascular diseases. The American Heart Association does not recommend the use of B vitamin supplements for this purpose. Riboflavin is found mostly in meat and fortified foods, but also in some nuts and green vegetables. The main sources of riboflavin are milk and yogurt, cheese, eggs, lean meats, organ meats, kidneys and liver, chicken breast, salmon, fortified grains, cereals and bread, almonds, spinach, quinoa, and some fruits and vegetables contain riboflavin. Because riboflavin is soluble in water, about twice as much riboflavin content is lost in cooking water when foods are boiled as when they are prepared in other ways, such as by steaming or microwaving. The recommended dietary allowance for men and women ages 19 plus years is 1.3 and 1.1 milligrams daily, respectively. For pregnancy and lactation, the amount increases to 1.4 milligrams and 1.6 milligrams daily, respectively. A tolerable upper intake level is the maximum daily dose unlikely to cause adverse side effects in the general population. An upper intake level has not been established for riboflavin because a toxic level has not been observed from food sources or from longer-term intakes of high-dose supplements. Riboflavin status is not routinely measured in healthy people. A stable and sensitive measure of riboflavin deficiency is the erythrocyte glutathione reductase activity coefficient, EGRAC. An EGRAC of 1.2 or less is usually used to indicate adequate riboflavin status, 1.2-1.4 to indicate marginal deficiency, and greater than 1.4 to indicate riboflavin deficiency. However, this indicator does not always correlate with riboflavin deficiency. Moreover, it cannot be used in people with a specific enzyme deficiency. Another widely used measure of riboflavin status is fluorometric measurement of the urinary excretion over 24 hours. In urine, riboflavin appears only when the tissues are saturated with it. Total riboflavin excretion in healthy riboflavin replete adults is at least 120 micrograms per day. A rate of less than 40 micrograms per day indicates deficiency. However, for long-term monitoring of vitamin B2 status, this test is less sensitive than EGRAC. In addition, urinary excretion of riboflavin may decrease with age and increase with stress and certain medications. Riboflavin deficiency develops with a lack of vitamin B2 in food or with diseases of the gastrointestinal tract and liver. The signs and symptoms of riboflavin deficiency, also known as ariboflavinosis, include skin disorders, hyperemia, excess blood, and edema of the mouth and throat, angular stomatitis, lesions of the corners of the mouth, hyalosis, swollen cracked lips, glossitis or swollen tongue, and specific pigmentation of the tongue, as well as hair loss, reproductive problems, sore throat, itchy and red eyes, and degeneration of the liver and nervous system. If riboflavin deficiency is severe and prolonged, a person could suffer from anemia and different eye lesions, such as conjunctivitis, blepharospasm, photophobia, burning sensation, cataracts, lacrimation, and vascularization of the cornea with decreased visual acuity. The earlier changes associated with riboflavin deficiency are easily reversed. However, riboflavin supplements rarely reverse later anatomical changes, such as formation of cataracts. Groups at high risk of deficiency: vegans and vegetarians, due to a lower intake or complete exclusion of dairy and meat products, pregnant women, especially in those who consume little meat or dairy, lactose intolerance due to increased nutrient needs with a growing fetus. Systemic riboflavin deficiency can develop after phototherapy due to neonatal jaundice or certain skin disorders. As with thymine, the toxic level of riboflavin has not been observed from food sources and supplements. The gut can only absorb a limited amount of riboflavin at one time, and an excess is quickly excreted in the urine. Therefore, a tolerable upper intake level for riboflavin has not been established. Toxicity is infrequent when consumed orally from the diet. However, deleterious effects like hepatotoxicity, cytotoxicity, and damage to lenticular and retinal proteins can occur due to repeatedly taking pharmacologic doses. Following the advice of Dr. Earl Mindel, both small and large doses are allowed. Like most B vitamins, the effectiveness of riboflavin is increased when taken in a well-balanced formula with other vitamins. The usual daily dose is 100-300 mg. You should take vitamin B2 supplements if you are pregnant or breastfeeding, if you are on birth control pills, if you consume low amounts of red meat and dairy products, and also if you are under prolonged stress. Riboflavin can decrease the effectiveness of cancer medicines, so you should consult your doctor before taking supplements. This part of my story about vitamin B2 is extremely short. Riboflavin is not known to have any clinically relevant interaction with medications. Riboflavin might be included in the treatment and prevention of human pellagra and probably of black tongue in dogs. This vitamin promotes growth and could cure and prevent dermatitis in rats. I found some interesting research. The experiments show that when the worm's diet includes live bacteria, they develop normally from larvae into adults. However, if the worms were fed only bacteria that had been killed by cooking and exposure to light, which damages vitamin B2, they stopped eating, shut down the production of 2K digestive enzymes, and stopped growing. Supplying these worms with extra vitamin B2 or extra digestive enzymes stimulates the worms to start eating the cooked bacteria. This vitamin is involved in the process by which cells make chemical energy, which is needed to fuel many biological processes. Animals and human beings require vitamin B2 to grow and to remain healthy. If you have any questions, write them down below. In the next video, I will continue to share with you interesting data about B vitamins. Take care of your body and mind. Thank you.